was born in Geneva, Switzerland.
And why was that? How did that happen?
Because I wanted to be near my mother.
And why was your mother in Geneva, Switzerland?
Well, we lived on the lake, the French side of the Lake of Geneva, and Geneva was maybe 30 miles away from us. So I went to boarding school in my hometown, then I went to boarding school in Switzerland, then I ended up in Paris with the same order that, and they believed that everybody should wear, you know, violet, because to signify that they were sorry that Marie Antoinette was dead. Well, anyway, so we were in violet.
For how many years did you wear violet?
2-4 years.
My goodness.
And I do mean violet.
Deep purple.
Violet. We had a blouse that was a little lighter than the rest of the uniform, but it was violet. Our hats were violet, our coats were violet, and of course in Paris we were taken out twice a week, I think, on walks to the park. And everybody knew who we were because we were the violet girls. In Paris, we lived in this condom that had been God knows what. But anyway, it had this huge staircase with a, you know, a railing. And there was nobody there, and I thought it'd be fun to some. And at the end of the railing was the Mother Superior. And, but she was... Actually, I liked her. Of all the nuns that I have seen, and I liked her because she was an intelligent woman, and she had been, you know, whatever. And so she looked at me and she said, "All right, I've been wanting to do that for a long time." So that was my only, you know, I thought she was going to give me 10 days or whatever. But no, she was a nice woman. And actually, when I went back to France, you know, as far as I was concerned, all these women were certainly in the hundreds. And they were old. Very old. Well, of course they were. And when I went back to France, I went to see them. And they were still living, to my absolute surprise. I thought, oh, of course they had all died. Well, no, they were middle-aged.
They just seemed much older than you.
So they were, and she was still there, and we had a nice talk.
Oh, that's cool.
That happened. I didn't meet my husband until 1940. Because at that time, he was in law school in New York, and he came up to Massachusetts to give tennis lessons, because he loved tennis for one thing, and it gave him a little money to achieve law school. So that's how I met him. He gave me tennis lessons. But he thought it was easier to marry me than to teach me tennis. You know, the war was really raging and all that, and of course the draft. So we went on a honeymoon and my husband left a note with the draft board in New York saying, "I've gone on my honeymoon, you can catch me." We're going to Arizona. So we went, and they did catch him. So we had a couple of years at Fort Bliss. It was not very well named.
It was not Bliss?
No.
Okay.
We had, in those days, you had dust storms. And the dust would come in. We'd find dust in kitchen drawers. I mean, it was unbelievable. This friend of mine came and said, "You don't go to church, you should go to church and come with church with me on Sunday." So I did. And it was nice because, of course, it was a church where my great aunt had gone, you know, on Sundays and mm-hmm. stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So I knew it, and it was good.
So this was in Massachusetts?
In Lenox, Mass.
Lenox, okay.
Mm-hmm. And after 2-3 months of that, the rector of the church came to see me and said, if you're going to come to church, I think you should become an Episcopalian.
Mm-hmm.
I said, sure. So he gave me a little book. And then actually, who was he? Bishop Tutu, you know,
uh-huh.
Africa,
uh-huh. Uh-huh.
came to Lenox to pay a visit.
Uh-huh.
And that's who confirmed me.
Oh my goodness.